हेलो एवरीवन, यू आर वाचिंग एजुकेट योर सेल्फ विद सारा। अच्छा, लास्ट एपिसोड में हमने जो फोर्थ चैप्टर का जो पार्ट स्टार्ट किया था, जो फिफ्थ पार्ट था, उसमें हमने अंडरस्टैंडिंग द ले ऑफ द लैंड को हमने स्टार्ट किया था, जो कि कंप्लीट नहीं हुआ था। तो आज इस एपिसोड में हम उसको कंप्लीट करेंगे सबसे पहले, और दूसरा ये कि आज इस सिक्स पार्ट में हम इस चैप्टर को भी, जो चैप्टर फोर्थ है, इस चैप्टर को भी कंप्लीट करने जा रहे हैं। तो मे बी वीडियो थोड़ी सी लंबी हो जाए, उसके लिए इस पहले ही मैं माजत करती हूँ आप सबसे। तो चलिए स्टार्ट करते हैं। इन द 19th सेंचुरी एब्सोल्यूटिज्म नॉट सो डिफरेंट फ्रॉम दैट इन अफ्रीका और ईस्टर्न यूरोप वॉज ब्लॉकिंग द पाथ ऑफ इंडस्ट्रियलाइजेशन इन मच ऑफ एशिया। इन चाइना द स्टेट वॉज स्ट्रांगली एब्सोल्यूटिस्ट एंड इंडिपेंडेंट सिटीज मर्चेंट्स एंड इंडस्ट्रियलिस्ट्स वर इधर नॉन एग्जिस्टेंट आर मच वीकर पॉलिटिकली। China was a major naval power and heavily involved in long distance trade centuries before the Europeans. But it had turned away from the oceans just at the wrong time when Ming empires decided in the late 14th and early 15th century that increased long distance trade and the creative destruction that it might bring would be likely to threaten their rule. In India, institutional drift worked differently and led to the development of a uniquely rigid hereditary caste system that limited the functioning of markets and the allocation of labor across occupations much more severely than the feudal order in medieval Europe. It also underpinned another strong form of absolutism under the Mughal rulers. ये इंडिया की बात हो रही है, ठीक है, सब कॉन्टिनेंट की बात हो रही है। मोस्ट यूरोपियन कंट्रीज हैड सिमिलर systems in the Middle Ages. Modern Anglo-Saxon surnames such as Baker, Cooper and Smith are direct descendants of hereditary occupational categories. Bakers baked, Coopers made barrels and Smith forged metals. But these categories were never as rigid as Indian caste distinctions and gradually become meaningless as predictors of a person's occupation. Though Indian merchants did trade throughout the Indian Ocean and a major textile industry developed, the caste system and Mughal absolutism were serious impediments to the development of inclusive economic institutions in India. By the 19th century, things were even less hospitable for industrialization as India became an extractive colony of the English. China was never formally colonized by a European power, but after the English successfully defeated the Chinese in the Opium Wars between 1839 and 1842, and then again between 1856 and 1860s, China had to sign a series of humiliating treaties and allow European exports to enter. अच्छा, इसमें हमें ये भी पता चलता है कि जो यूरोपियन जो ओपियम वार्स हुई थी वो का उसका इरा कब से था, 1939 से 1942 तक था, ठीक है। ये इसका और दूसरी दफ़ा ये इसकी सीरीज जो चली थी वो 56 से 60 तक चली थी। एज चाइना, इंडिया एंड अदर्स file to take advantage of commercial and industrial opportunities, Asia except for Japan lagged behind as Western Europe was forged ahead. The course of initial development that Japan charted in the 19th century again illustrates the interaction between critical junctures and small differences created by institutional drift. Japan, like China, was under absolutist rule. The Tokugawa family took over in 1600 and ruled over a feudal system that also banned international trade. Japan too faced a critical juncture created by Western interventions as four U.S. warships commanded by Matthew C. Perry entered Edo Bay in July 1853, demanding trade concessions similar to those England obtained from the Chinese in the Opium Wars. But these critical junctures played out very differently in Japan. Despite their proximity and frequently interactions, by the 19th century, China and Japan had already drifted apart institutionally. While Tokugawa rule in Japan was absolutist and extractive, it had only a tenacious hold on the leaders of other major feudal domains and was susceptible to challenge. अच्छा टेनिस कहते हैं कमज़ोर को कहते हैं, ठीक है, मतलब उसकी वहाँ पे जो होल था उनका वो बहुत कमज़ोर था, और सस्पेक्टेबल कहते हैं काबल को कहते हैं. इवन दो देर वर पीजेंट रिबेलियंस एंड सिविल स्ट्रीफ, स्ट्रीफ कहते हैं झगड़े को कहते हैं या कॉन्फ्लिक्ट को, अब्सोल्यूटिज्म इन चाइना वाज स्ट्रॉन्गर एंड द अपोजिशन less organized and autonomous. There were no equivalents of the leaders of the other domains in China who could challenge the absolutist rule of the empire and trace an alternative institutional path. These institutional differences in many ways small relative to the differences separating China and Japan from Western Europe had devices consequences during the critical juncture created by the forceful arrival of the English and Americans. China continued in the absolutist path after the Opium Wars, while the US threat cemented the opposition to Tokugawa rule in Japan and led to the political revolution. Cemented कहते हैं जोड़ना मिलाना किसी भी चीज़ को. The Meiji Restoration, as well see in Chapter 10, this Japanese political revolution enabled more inclusive political institutions and much more inclusive economic institutions to develop and laid the foundation for subsequent rapid Japanese growth while China languished under absolutism. How Japan reacted to the threat posed by the US warship by starting a process of fundamental institutional transformation help us understand another aspect of the lay of the land around us. Transition from stagnation to rapid growth, South Korea, Taiwan and finally China achieved breakneck rates for economic growth since the Second World War through a path similar to the one that Japan took. In each of these cases, growth was preceded by historic changes in the country's economic institution, though not always in their political institution, as the Chinese case highlights. The logic of how episodes of rapid growth come to an abrupt end and reversed is also related. In the same way that decisive steps towards inclusive economic institution can ignite rapid economic growth, a sharp turn away from inclusive institution can lead to economic stagnation. But more often, collapse of rapid growth, such as in Argentina or a Soviet Union, are a consequence of growth under extractive institution coming to an end. As we have seen, this can happen either because of infighting over the spoils of extractions. स्पाइल्स कहते हैं तबाही को कहते हैं बर्बादी को कहते हैं लीडिंग टू द कोलैप्स ऑफ द रिजीम आर बिकॉज द इनहेरेंट लैक ऑफ इनोवेशन एंड क्रिएटिव डिस्ट्रक्शन अंडर एक्सट्रैक्टिव इंस्टीट्यूशन पाथ पुट्स अ लिमिट ऑन सस्टेन ग्रोथ. हाउ द सोवियत रेन हार्ट इन टू दीज लिमिट्स विल बी डिस्कस इन ग्रेटर डिटेल्स इन द नेक्स्ट चैप्टर. If the political and economic institutions of Latin America over the past 500 years were shaped by Spanish colonialism, those of the Middle East were shaped by Ottoman colonialism. In 1453, the Ottoman under Sultan Mehmed II captured Constantinople. अच्छा ये यहाँ से एक ये MCQs भी मिलता हमें कि Constantinople को किसने फतह किया था, तो वो सुल्तान मेहमद टू थे जिन्होंने फतह किया था 1453 में. The Ottomans conquered large part of the Balkans and most of the rest of Turkey. In the first half of the 16th century, Ottoman rule spread throughout the Middle East and North Africa. By 1566, at the death of the Sultan Suleiman I, known as the Magnificent, their empire stretched from Tunisia in the east through the Egypt all the way to Mecca in the Arabian Peninsula and on what is now modern Iraq. The Ottoman state was absolutist, with the Sultan accountable to few and sharing power with none. The economic institution the Ottomans imposed were highly extractive. There were no private property in land, which all formally belonged to the state. Taxation of the land and agricultural output, together with load from war, was the main source of government revenues. However, the Ottoman state did not dominate the Middle East in the same way that it could dominate its heartland in Anatolia, or even to the extent that the Spanish state dominated Latin American society. The Ottoman state was continuously challenged by Beduinis and other tribal powers in the Arabian Peninsula. It lacked now not only the ability to impose a stable order in much of the Middle East, but also the administrative capacity to collect taxes. So it framed them out to individuals, selling off the right to others to collect taxes in whatever way they could. These tax framers became autonomous and powerful. Rates of taxation in the Middle Eastern territories were very high, varying between 1/2 or 2/3 of what farmers produced. Much of the revenue was kept by the tax farmers because the Ottoman state failed to establish a stable order in these areas. Property rights were far from secure, and there was a great deal of lawlessness and banditry as armed groups vied for local control. बैंडिट्री कहते हैं डाका जाने को या रह जाने को, यानी लूट मार को कहते हैं. इन पैलेस्टाइन फॉर एग्जांपल, द सिचुएशन वाज सो डायर दैट स्टार्टिंग इन द लेट 16th century पीजेंट्स लेफ्ट द मोस्ट फर्टाइल लैंड एंड मूव्ड अप टू माउंटेनियस एरियाज, विच गेव देम ग्रेटर प्रोटेक्शन अगेंस्ट बैंडिट्री, यानी रह जाने, यानी डाका जानी, चोरी से उनको प्रोटेक्शन मिली जब उन्होंने माउंटेनियस एरियाज की तरफ मूव किया. एक्सट्रैक्टिव इकोनॉमिक इंस्टीट्यूशन इन द अर्बन एरियाज ऑफ द ऑटोमन एम्पायर वर नो लेस स्टिफलिंग. स्टिफलिंग कहते हैं गला घोंट कर मारने को कहते हैं. कॉमर्स वॉज अंडर स्टेट कंट्रोल एंड ऑक्यूपेशन वर स्ट्रिक्टली रेगुलेटेड बाई गिल्ड्स एंड मोनोपोलीज. The consequences was that at the time of the Industrial Revolution, the economic institutions of the Middle East were extractive. The region stagnated economically. By the 1840s, the Ottomans were trying to reform institutions, for example, by reversing tax farming and getting locally autonomous groups under control. But absolutism persisted until the First World War, and reform efforts were thwarted by the usual fear of creative destruction and the anxiety among elite groups that they would lose economically or politically. Thwarted कहते हैं खत्म करने को या फिर उलट देने को कहते हैं. While Ottoman reformers talked of introducing private property rights to land in order to increase agricultural productivity, the status quo persisted because of the desire for political control and taxation. Ottoman colonization was followed by European colonization after 1980s. When European control ended, the same dynamics we have seen in sub-Saharan Africa took hold, with extractive colonial institutions take over by independent elites. In some cases, such as the monarchy of Jordan, these elites were direct creation of the colonial powers. But this too happened frequently in Africa, as we will see. Middle Eastern countries without oil today have income levels similar to poor Latin American nations. They did not suffer from such immiserizing forces as the slave trade, and they benefited for a longer period from flows of technology from Europe. In the Middle Ages, the Middle East itself was also a relative advanced part of the world economically. So today it is not as poor as Africa, but the majority of its people still live in poverty. अच्छा, आगे इसके बाद इस चैप्टर की समरी दी हुई है जो मैं आपके साथ इंशाल्लाह रीड करूँगी अभी इसी एपिसोड में. तो ये आगे समरी देख लेते हैं. वी हैव सीन दैट नीदर ज्योग्राफिक नार कल्चर नार इग्नोरेंस बेस्ड थियोरीज आर हेल्पफुल फॉर एक्सप्लेनिंग द ले ऑफ द लैंड अराउंड अस. दे डू नॉट प्रोवाइड अ सेटिसफैक्ट्री अकाउंट फॉर द प्रोमिनेंट पैटर्न्स ऑफ वर्ल्ड इनइक्वालिटी. द फैक्ट दैट द प्रोसेस ऑफ इकोनॉमिक डाइवर्जेंस स्टार्टेड विद द इंडस्ट्रियल रेवोल्यूशन इन इंग्लैंड ड्यूरिंग द 18th एंड 19th सेंचुरीज एंड देन स्प्रेड टू वेस्टर्न यूरोप एंड टू यूरोपियन सेटलर कॉलोनीज. द परसिस्टेंट डाइवर्जेंस बिटवीन डिफरेंट पार्ट्स ऑफ द अमेरिकाज दैट पॉवर्टी ऑफ अफ्रीका ऑफ द मिडल ईस्ट the divergence between eastern and western europe and the transition from stagnation to growth and the sometimes abrupt end to growth spurts. abrupt kehte hain achanak, theek hai, aur growth spurts kehte hain phootne ko ya phalne phoolne ko kehte hain. over institutional theory does. In the remaining chapter, we will discuss in greater detail how this institution theory works and illustrate the wide range of phenomena it can account for. These range from the origins of the Neolithic Revolution to the collapse of reversal civilization, either because of the intrinsic limits to growth under extractive institutions or because of limited step toward inclusiveness being reversed. We will see how many.
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar.
Sorry about that. We will see how and why this. Decisive steps towards inclusive political institutions were taken during the Glorious Revolution in England. We will look more specifically at the following: how inclusive institutions emerged from the interplay of the critical juncture created by Atlantic trade and the nature of pre-existing English institutions, how these institutions persisted and became strengthened to lay the foundation for the Industrial Revolution, thanks in part to the virtuous circle and in part to fortunate turns of contingency. How many regimes ranging over absolutist and extractive institutions steadfastly resisted the spread of new technologies unleashed by the Industrial Revolution. How Europeans themselves stamped out the possibility of economic growth in many parts of the world that they conquered. How the vicious circle and the iron day of oligarchy have created a powerful tendency for extractive institutions to persist. And thus the lay and thus the lands where the Industrial Revolution originally did not spread remain relatively poor. While the Industrial Revolution and other new technologies have not spread and are unlikely to spread to place around the world today where a minimum degree of centralization of the state has not been achieved. Our discussion will also show that certain areas that managed to transform institutions in a more inclusive direction, such as France or Japan, are that prevented the establishment of extractive institutions such as the United States or Australia, were more respective to the spread of the Industrial Revolution and pulled ahead for the rest. As in England, this was not always a smooth process, and along the way, many challenges to inclusive institutions were overcome and sometimes became of the dynamics of the virtuous circle, sometimes thanks to the contingent path of history. Finally, we will also discuss how the failure of nations today is heavily influenced by their institutional histories, how many policy advice is informed by incorrect hypotheses and is potentially misleading, and how nations are still able to seize critical juncture and break the mold to reform their institution and embark upon a path to greater prosperity. So, ये था चैप्टर नंबर 4. तो इस चैप्टर में हमने देखा कि कैसे एक इंक्लूसिव जो इंस्टीट्यूशन होते हैं, पॉलिटिकल इंक्लूसिव पॉलिटिकल और इकोनॉमिक इंस्टीट्यूशन, वो कैसे किसी भी कंट्री की ग्रोथ में हेल्पफुल होते हैं और कैसे एक्सट्रैक्टिव इंस्टीट्यूशंस जिसमें किसी भी इंसान को कोई फ्रीडम नहीं होती, ना बिजनेस करने की, ना अपना ऑक्यूपेशन सेलेक्ट करने की, किसी चीज़ की फ्रीडम नहीं होती, उसको अपने रूलर्स के मुताबिक अपनी ज़िंदगी गुजारनी होती है, अपना ऑक्यूपेशन को सेलेक्ट करना होता है, तो वो कैसे किसी भी कंट्री की ग्रोथ में जो है ना वो रुकावट बनते हैं। तो इस चैप्टर में हमने बहुत सारी एग्जांपल्स देखी, बहुत सारे डेवलप्ड कंट्रीज़ की, बहुत सारे डेवलपिंग कंट्रीज़ की एग्जांपल्स देखी। आई होप आप सबको समझ आ गई होगी। थैंक यू सो मच फॉर वॉचिंग एंड अल्लाह हाफिज़।